You know, Rajnish, like the common human beings, he had two eyes, one nose, two hands, long beard. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he is not God. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدٌ. For example, if someone says that Almighty God is 1,000 times stronger than Arnold Schwarzenegger. You may have heard the name Arnold Schwarzenegger, the person who got the title Mr. Universe, the strongest man in the universe, the strongest man in the world. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, whether it be 1,000 times or whether it be 1,000,000 times, whether it be Arnold Schwarzenegger, whether it be Dara Singh or whether it be King Kong, the moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he is not God. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدٌ. There is nothing like him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God. If we can prove to the atheist that this is the concept of God, surely he will not reject the true concept of God. What we have, what we see around us, when an atheist sees the false concept of God, that this God can be defeated, this God can be hurt, this God requires help, this God requires to eat, he requires to sleep, he requires to rest. So these atheists, with their logic, they say, how can we worship someone who requires rest, who requires to eat, who requires to sleep, who requires help, who's not all powerful, who's not absolute, who's not eternal, who can die? So that's the reason the atheists, they reject these false gods. And that is the first part of the Islamic Shahada, that is La Ilaha. So anyone who believes in logic and believes in any scripture will have to agree in the concept of true God. But there are many atheists, the majority of them, who believe in science. For them, science is the ultimate test. They tell me, Brother Zakir, you prove to me the existence of God through science and we'll believe in it. Most of the atheists, for them, science is ultimate, because today is the age of science and technology. So inshallah, in the next part of my speech, I will prove to the scientific atheist, an atheist who believes in science, the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the help of the Quran as well as modern science. The first question I'll ask an atheist who believes science is ultimate, and ask him that if an equipment is bought in front of you, if an equipment who no one in the world has ever seen, who no one knows about it, if it's put in front of the atheist and the question is asked that who will be able to tell you the mechanism, who is the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this equipment who no one has seen before? Can anyone guess that if you ask an atheist that who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of an equipment, of a machine, who no one in the world has ever seen? Who will be the first person? Can you guess? Can anyone guess? Manufacturer, very good. MashaAllah, correct answer. Any other answer? Creator, very good. MashaAllah, the people of Colombo are intelligent. Manufacturer, creator, maker, inventor, producer. Whenever you ask any atheist that who is the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of an equipment who no one in the world has seen, and the answer will be manufacturer, creator, inventor, maker, producer, somewhat similar, just keep it at the back of your mind. The first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of any equipment who no one else knows is the manufacturer, the creator, the inventor, the maker, the producer. The second person would be whoever the inventor, manufacturer, creator has told. But the first person is the creator, inventor, maker, manufacturer, somewhat similar. Keep it at the back of your mind. The next question I'll ask to the atheist is, how did our universe come into existence? The atheist will say that initially there was one primary nebula. Our whole universe was one primary nebula. Then there was a secondary separation. There was a big bang which gave rise to galaxies, the stars, the planets, the sun, the moon, and the earth on which we live. When you ask this atheist that when did you come to know about this, so he will tell you this was first told and discovered by a couple of scientists in the early part of 1970s, for which they got the Nobel Prize. About 40 years back, there were a group of scientists who told the world how did the universe come into existence, and they called it the Big Bang. I will tell the atheist, what you say you have come to know 40 years back and what you call the Big Bang is already mentioned in the book which I read, the glorious Quran. It's mentioned 1400 years ago in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, which says, Awalam yaral lazina kafru, do not the unbelievers see, anna samawati wal arda, kanatarat kanfataknahuma, that the heaven and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder. What you're talking about, the Big Bang, the creation of the universe, which you came to know 40 years back, is already mentioned in this book, the glorious Quran, 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned that in the Quran? So the atheist will say, maybe someone wrote, maybe it's a fluke, maybe it's a guesswork. No problem. Don't argue with him. Continue. You ask the atheist that the light of the moon, is it its own light or is it reflected light? So the atheist will tell you that previously we human beings thought the light of the moon was its own light. Recently, 200 years back, 300 years back, we came to know that the light of the moon is not its own light, but it's a reflected light. I will tell him that what you came to know recently, 200, 300 years back, is already mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago. The Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 61, that blessed is he who has made the constellations in the sky, placed therein sun having its own light, and the moon having reflected or borrowed light. The Quran refers to the sun as Shams, and his light is always described as Siraj, Wahaj, or Diya, meaning a blazing torch, a lamp, or a shining glory. And the sun is referred in the Quran as Qamar, and its light is always described as Munir or Noor, meaning borrowed light or reflected light. And this message, besides Surah Furqan, chapter 25, verse number 61, is also mentioned in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 5, as well as Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse 15, that, and in Surah Nuh, chapter 71, verse number 14 and 15, that the light of the moon is a borrowed light or reflected light. Who could have mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago that the light of the moon is not its own light, but it's a reflected or borrowed light? So the atheist will give a pause, but may say, maybe, you know, your prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, maybe you're super intelligent. Don't argue.